They
time to buy a brand new 88 Oldsmobile, rocket engine power and big car feel.
The 50s were exuberant. We'd come out of a war, unsatisfied demand for everything, from homes to washing machines to automobiles. We sold everything we could make. And it was exuberance. I can't think of a better word.
It's out of this world. Take a look at the new Ford for 1950.
The exuberance of the 1950s flowed from the fact that post-World War II America was the richest country in history. More than half of everything made or sold in the world was made or sold in the United States.
Find a wheel and it goes round, round, round as it skims along with a happy sound as it goes along the ground, ground, ground till it leads you to the world.
Americans saw themselves as pioneers on a new consumer frontier, strong, outwardly confident, carefree, and on the road to a glowing future.
7 seconds after launching, the rocket is a ruin. America has suffered a grave scientific setback.
Wrapped up in their dreams of the good life, Americans were in for a rude awakening.
Life in America has changed. So it is that we can make our living on a farm and have a home in town. So it is that we can live where we want to. And the shopping centers now come out to meet us.
I'm out to go wandering along the mountain track. And as I go, I love to sing my knapsack on my back.
The 50s were a time when Americans started to move like they had never moved before. In 1950, Americans owned 40 million cars and trucks, a number that would double by the end of the decade. In 1956, President Eisenhower signed the Federal Aid Highway Act, and work began on a 42,000-mile system of interstate highways. For the first time, life in America had a fast lane. To serve the mobile masses, drive-in restaurants popped up all over the country.
Come join my happy soul. Lottery.
Entrepreneurs were quick to come up with gimmicks to turn fast food into fast profits. But no one would understand the need for speed better than two brothers in San Bernardino, California. Dick and Mac McDonald.
After World War II, their attitudes were completely different. They were impatient, and we were beginning to get many complaints how slow the service was. We decided if the customer wants fast service, we're going to give them fast service.
The brothers slashed their menu from 25 items to focus on three: hamburgers, fries, and milkshakes. They boasted that you could get served not in 20 minutes, but in 20 seconds.
They made the decision, a hamburger or a cheeseburger. They pre-selected the condiments, a dab of ketchup, a dab of mustard, a touch of onion, a little pickle, the roll, bingo, that's done. You don't get a choice. You get French fries and you can get a shake. We'll make the decisions. They mechanized and speeded up the whole process and kept the price down and kept the quality up.
I was there on opening day and sold the first McDonald's hamburger. In fact, I sold six of them. The first order was six hamburgers at 15 cents a piece, 90 cents. And that was the start of a great dynasty.
You
was like being in a fishbowl. People could look in front and both sides of the store and see everything that was being done. And I think that was important to a lot of people, especially in those days when there was a lot of bad product put out. It was great. And it was fast.
I think McDonald's was like Levittown on a bun. I mean, it was that same wonderful uniformity. No surprises. Also, the great genius, of course, was fast food, because again, you had to have fast food or you wouldn't have time for the 40 activities your children had after school each day. So as the culture changed, the food had to change with it.
By the early 50s, Dick and Mac's little hamburger stand was showing an annual profit of $200,000. The brothers decided to sell their first franchise to Phoenix businessman Neil Fox.
When we started the franchise, we had no intention of anybody using the name. What we were going to sell them was a building layout, an equipment layout. They wouldn't have to worry about getting a contractor to design this and that. But we had no intention of them using our name, primarily because our name meant nothing, you know, outside of San Bernardino. But for some reason, Neil Fox wanted to use the name. See, he says, I think he says the name would be lucky. See? And we tried to talk him out of it. We said, oh, forget it, Neil. Nobody in Phoenix ever heard of McDonald's. Well, he said, and he kept after us. So one day my brother said, listen, Neil's such a good egg, he says. If he wants to use the name, so what?
The invention of the golden arches was Dick's idea. One architect called them a bad dream. Another agreed to include them in his blueprints only after McDonald's agreed not to divulge the architect's identity. With the addition of more franchises, the success of the McDonald's drive-ins caught the eye of one of their suppliers, a milkshake machine salesman known as Mr. Multimixer, Ray Kroc.
One day I'm sitting in my office as the fellow came in. He says, had a high voice. He says, hi, my name is Ray Kroc. He said, I can't understand it. No matter where I get, the line is still out to the street. He said, do people stand in a line like that to get a milkshake and a hamburger? And I says, that's it. He says, well, how long will those lines continue? And I says, till we close down tonight. He could not believe it.
When I saw the McDonald brothers, I envisioned selling hundreds of muddle mixers and getting a profit on the muddle mixer. And that's all I thought about right then.
Ray Kroc finally did see a future in hamburgers. He became McDonald's franchise agent and set about fine-tuning the fast food formula.
Production control begins with the very first batch of 12 hamburgers. Bun tops are put on first and covered with a bun board, followed by bun bottoms.
Although the franchisees were independent businessmen, they had to adhere to rigid rules.
Get those hamburger patties over.
There's a wonderful note that he sends the McDonald's talking about the dangers of individualism within the company. This is in 1958. He writes to them, he says, we have found out, as you have, that we cannot trust some people who are nonconformists. We will make conformists out of them in a hurry. Even personal friends who we know have the best of intentions may not conform. They have a difference of opinion as to various processing and certain qualities of product. You cannot give them an inch. The organization cannot trust the individual. The individual must trust the organization, or he shouldn't go into this kind of business. Don't cross Ray Kroc.
Well, Ray was fastidious and very well manicured, and he expected this of everyone who was involved with him in the company. So Ray had this leather packet. You'd put your business cards, your file, and your comb. And then one day, he added a new feature to the packet. It would fit inside your breast pocket. And the new feature he added was a pair of small tweezers. And this was to clip the hair in your nose. Well, I went home that night and looked, and oh my God, I could see I needed the tweezers, and I think I realized where this tweezer idea came from. Ray was a very competitive guy. You know, he had an expression that I used to just wince when he'd say it. But he'd get up in front of a group of licensees, and his saying was, well, if he saw a competitor drowning, he'd grab a hose and help him.
Under Croc's leadership, the business quickly expanded to 228 stands. Always on the lookout for ways to streamline operations and boost profits, Croc did not always see eye to eye with the founding fathers of fast food.
Ray Croc could not make any changes or add anything to the menu unless they had approval of the McDonald brothers, which was fine. The big problem there was, and Ray complained about this bitterly, he would call Mac and Dick on the phone and say, Dick, we want to use such and such Dixie cup now, or malt cup. Is that all right? Oh, sure, go ahead. He said, well, will you put it in writing? Send me a letter on it, so I have it in writing. Oh, that's all right, you don't have to bother with that. Well, Croc's lawyer would say, hey, wait a minute, you know, you're in violation of the franchise right there if you do it. And so Ray would have to call, hey, you know, let me have a letter. So, well, they would never do it.
For their interest in McDonald's, Ray Croc paid the brothers a total of $2.7 million. But that did not end the conflict.
Ray said that he understood that the existing McDonald's operation San Bernardino would be part of the package. And after the deal was done, the Mac brothers said, no, oh no, you don't get that store, that's our baby. And we're gonna keep it. Well, that's when Ray made this statement to me.
And that was?
I'm not a vindictive sort of person, but I'm gonna get those sons of bitches.
Ray Croc forced the brothers to take down the sign over their original San Bernardino restaurant, which then became known as the Big M. Dick and Mac McDonald took the money they got from Croc, bought a pair of brand new Cadillacs, and retired to their native New Hampshire.
I have been asked, do I have any regrets about selling out and so forth? And my answer is definitely no, because if we had continued, I would probably end up in a skyscraper somewhere and have about 14 accountants and two tax attorneys trying to save on income tax, and all for what? And I have a little strange philosophy too. I believe we're on this earth a rather short time, and I would say to anybody, have a little fun. Have a little fun while you're on this earth, and don't just let money be the thing that's predominant in your thinking all the time.
Dick and Mac McDonald could hardly have foreseen the influence their modest burger stand in San Bernardino would have on America's eating habits. Ray Croc went on to make McDonald's the largest food service conglomerate in the world, with over 20,000 outlets in 101 countries. The golden arches came to symbolize the pioneering spirit of the new American entrepreneur and the nation's need for speed. But the hallmark of the 50s was a machine that moved and defined a uniquely American style.
I've never enjoyed a modeling job as much as this one.
In post-war America, where jobs were plentiful and incomes rose steadily, cars became status symbols, machines that got you where you wanted to go, and boasted about how well you were doing along the way.
I feel like I'm in the lap of luxury.
In a way, it was a wonderful, naive time because people were very accepting and very ready for something new. And unfortunately, when the war stopped, most of the cars just were the warmed over 1942 models. And that was okay, that got them into a car, but not what they were really looking for. They were looking for something that was on that popular science cover.
Hey, I wonder what we'd hear if I'd turn on the switch and we're driving along in 1976. Hello, Tower. This is Firebird 2304.
How are things
the automobile was the quintessential dream machine. Cars were a perfect way for Americans to define themselves because they answered a fundamental American need, which is to move. I mean, with an automobile, whenever you wanted to get in your car, you could get in it and go wherever you wanted to go. And that sense of freedom is something that I think we Americans not only feel is a birthright, but I think have always been very proud of and very, very reluctant to give up.
Boom, boom, boom.
Nadia often call me Speedo, but my real name is Mister.
Harley Earl was the man who turned American cars into dream machines. As a young man, Earl had designed custom car bodies for Hollywood celebrities. When he moved to General Motors in Detroit, he became America's most influential designer.
Ban roll-on deodorant was a Harley Earl idea. We take it for granted now, but the idea of roll-on deodorant was something that he came up with. Orange naugahyde, which again we sort of take for granted as an element of the 1950s, that was a Harley Earl idea too.
The styling job is a job for today, but its essence is forecasting, the scientific anticipation of the whims and needs and preferences of GM customers tomorrow. Behind the scenes,
at one time, engineers ran GM. Now they took a back seat to Harley Earl's styling department.
By deadlines and divisional dictates, here the motor car stylist does the equivalent of pure research in the field of applied money-making art.
The first idea of an automotive styling studio was invented by Harley Earl in GM going back before the 50s. He was so powerful that he said, Chevrolet, that's your style, and Pontiac, that's yours, and Olds, that's yours, and so forth. He ran the styling roost with an iron hand. He had the power given to him by the boss, and he exercised it with great flamboyance.
The dawning of the jet age inspired Harley Earl. He named his revolutionary dream car the LeSabre, after a jet fighter.
Nobody went out and took a survey or asked people what they wanted to have next year. Harley Earl didn't believe in it. He sensed what they liked now. He sensed what was going on, and then he gave what he thought was the best interpretation of what people would like. He used to use the expression, Hattie Carnegie didn't go around to New York asking ladies which kind of a hat they were going to want next fall. She just showed them what kind of hat they were going to have next fall.
One half of all cars sold in the United States were made by GM. Today they have a third of the market, to give you a scale. Which meant they set the standards, they set prices, they set the broadest aspects of styling, like more chrome GM puts on, we put on more chrome. So with half the market dominating the industry by all those price classes, they were what you fought against. They were the 800-pound gorilla.
When he saw that caravan of trucks rolling down the road, Stevie realized the Motorama had come to town. He couldn't...
In the days before television came to dominate the selling of automobiles in America, Earl promoted his styles with a traveling auto show called the Motorama, that unveiled both current models and futuristic dream cars.
Some of the things we may enjoy in the world of tomorrow. I knew the Motorama was more than a display of the newest cars, that it's a demonstration of the teamwork of scientists, engineers, and stylists.
The original Corvette, which came out in 1953, was a fascinating example of Harley Earl marketing. The ad said, you don't have to just dream about this car, you can own one today. The Corvette was, in fact, a dream car. It began as a dream car, but they marketed it. And the original Corvette was not tremendously expensive, nor was it even very powerful. And yet, it, like everything else Harley Earl did, had a tremendous amount of sex appeal.
Harley Earl understood that for Americans on the move, sexy also meant new.
The model change was one of those great American events like the World Series. Everybody sat around and waited for it just to see what Detroit would come up with this year. There's something, on the one hand, kind of disgusting about this. Half of the United States standing around worrying about a Detroit car, although it certainly does spotlight the importance of the auto industry in keeping this grand American economic machine moving. On the other hand, there's something so innocent and exuberant and fun about it, as though these products in our lives really are going to be transformative, that if I get this new 1956 model Chevrolet, I'm going to be the hottest thing on the block, I'm going to be happy, my life is going to be wonderful, and the drive to work is going to be a treat.
Like so many people these days, we live in the suburbs, and Dave needs the car every day for business. When he was gone, I was practically a prisoner in my own home. But that's all changed now. 3 weeks ago, we bought another Ford.
In the suburbs, what car you drove and how many of them you had was a mark of your success or failure.
And I now have the ranch wagon all to myself. It's a whole new way of life.
Today, more and more families are finding out how easy it is to become two Ford families. You can choose.
There were so many different variations of cars. There was the perfect car for you. And if you got a raise of $40 a month, then there was a better car for you that reflected that raise. Automobiles were the ultimate way that Americans in the 1950s were able to express their kind of social and aesthetic longings.
Wow! Here's the car of the future right now. And what else can you say when it's coming your way? But wow!
By 1956, as America's automakers continued to fight for buyers in the styling arena, GM's annual advertising budget reached a staggering $100 million. Now increasingly dedicated to showcasing GM products on the new medium of television.
Probably the ultimate Harley Earl car, sort of the height of Harley Earlism, was the 1959 Cadillac, which was incredibly long, incredibly low, incredibly wide, and had tail fins that were, I believe, 44 inches off the ground, with points on them so sharp that there were many stories, possibly apocryphal, of pedestrians and roller skaters being impaled on these tail fins if they happened to get backed into by one of these cars. To see one of these vehicles today is absolutely astounding, because it is so wild. You just marvel that anyone dared actually produce this, and furthermore, that it was a very successful model.
As Harley Earl's cars grew more popular with the buying public, critics charged that he had lost touch with the basic rule of design, that form follows function.
And it's a continuous process which leads to monstrosities, lead to the point where, as I forecast 10 years ago in a book I wrote, where through its sheer absurdity of design, the whole thing collapses, and that there's a return to design sanity and restraint and good taste.
The most beautiful thing that ever happened to horsepower. That's the 1958 Edsel.
The first major casualty in the battle of style and excess was at Ford. The Edsel was the biggest production disaster in American automotive history. Ford spent $450 million on a car that few, besides the ad men, found appealing.
The Edsel was one of the worst design mistakes that the American auto industry ever made, because it seemed to say, we can sell you guys anything. And in fact, you couldn't. I think maybe this is the point at which the American advertiser and the American designer loses touch with the participatory, non-hierarchical interests of American people.
If the public demands and takes off your dealer showroom floors everything you make month after month at the prices you are charging and making good money, you became, what's the right word, hubric? Yeah, you had hubris.
Big cars meant big profits. With little incentive to provide economical transportation, Detroit barely noticed the arrival of a flood of low-priced imports. The Volkswagen was everything Detroit was not. It was small, it was cheap, and it looked like a sewing machine.
A Volkswagen is never changed to make it look different, only to make it work better.
These new European cars had stunning success, and it was a symbol, really, of the narrowness of Detroit and the fact that it really wasn't paying attention. And so when it finally responded late in the decade, it did not do so in an honest way.
Go, man, go! Go for true sports car feel and handling. Go for thrills and excitement. Go for the powerful thrust of turbocharged SCAT.
Well, the Corvair had two costs and one benefit. One cost was it was the climax of the trade-off between safety and style, with style winning. Second, it killed a lot of people and exposed a lot of people to carbon monoxide leakage. And third, it was so bad that it became a paradigm, what was wrong with the auto industry, and set the stage for the federal regulation of the auto industry for safety and pollution control.
In a moment, you'll see the new Corvair match its great performance against the skiing skill of Stein Erickson. And here they go.
As good as it looked on ski slopes, the Corvair had trouble on ordinary roads. To keep costs low, General Motors engineers cut down the size of the tires and eliminated a crucial stabilizing bar.
In your opinion, Mr. Nader, why, when it is possible for a safer car to be designed, is that safer automobile with those features not put on the market?
Well, basically, the problem is one of many years standing. The automobile industry has a formula for selling...
A young lawyer from Connecticut, Ralph Nader, launched his career as America's leading consumer advocate by exposing design flaws in GM cars with the publication of his book, Unsafe at Any Speed. At congressional hearings looking into Nader's allegations, GM was forced to acknowledge problems with the Corvair and apologize to Nader for hiring a private eye to investigate his personal life.
I am not here to excuse, condone, or justify in any way our investigating Mr. Nader. To the extent that General Motors bears responsibility, I want to apologize here and now to the members of this subcommittee and Mr. Nader.
GM lost its innocence in the public's limelight, and since it was the number one corporation in the world, that had a lot of fallout, leading to criticism of other companies, the food industry, the drug industry, the oil industry. The 50s were a wonderfully incubation period because so little happened. There was so much passivity. There was so little questioning. There was so much corporate dominance that it sort of fed a much more active reaction. Just like the 60s with their activities led to a slide in the 70s and 80s. These are cyclical changes in our society, and you have to have a 50s in order to have a 60s. Well, now they all can call me Speedo, but my
real name is Mr. Harley Earl's era of excess came to an end with his retirement in 1959. Facing foreign imports and consumer watchdogs, Detroit would never quite command the American imagination the way it had in the golden age of the tail fin. With Dwight Eisenhower and his vice president Richard Nixon at the helm, America seemed to be cruising toward limitless horizons of ease and prosperity. New fads swept a country in love with the ornaments of affluence. Then, in October 1957, an event occurred that that woke the country with a jolt.
CBS Television presents a special report on Sputnik 1, the Soviet space satellite. Douglas Edwards reporting. Until 2 days ago, that sound had never been heard on this Earth. Suddenly, it has become as much a part of 20th century life as the whir of your vacuum cleaner. It's a report from man's farthest frontier, the radio signal transmitted by the Soviet Sputnik, the first man-made satellite as it passed over New York earlier today.
The Russians? They beat us to space with this magnificent piece of technology, beeping away, circling the Earth at whatever the altitude was. The Russians are heavy. They build big, heavy stuff and it never works very well anyway. We could not believe that the Russians did that, and they did it before we did.
USSR had launched into space a small aluminum alloy sphere weighing 184 pounds. They called it Sputnik. It was a tiny object compared with what was to come, but it was a first, and the world stood by, transfixed by the achievement.
Shattered a lot of presuppositions which went on in the years to come to attribute a kind of a magical potency to the Soviet Union. It was predicted in the 60s that by 1980 their GDP would exceed that of the United States. Well, these went to preposterous lengths, but there is no denying what they accomplished in 1957. That was a huge culture shock in America.
Would you admire the Russians for doing it or not?
No, definitely not. I said we should have been the first ones to have it, if there's such thing.
Well, you would think the United States, the America would do something first. It gets the American people alarmed that a foreign country, especially an enemy country, can do this, and we fear this.
In its orbit, 560 miles above the Earth, the satellite reached a speed of 18,000 miles an hour.
I was working on the Corvette with an engineer that was a German guy, and a thing came over the speaker system that the Sputnik had gone, and he says, "Oh, my God, I was on the wrong side last time. Looks like I'm on the wrong side this time." But everybody was shook up by that, and it changed America a little bit.
In Washington, the public line was, Sputnik, the Russians have been able to put up a little something about the size of a basketball or a melon. And, well, good for them. I mean, if they can put up some little tiny thing like that and make it go around, we'll do a lot better very soon. That was the official public line. The private line, the inside line in the White House and the Pentagon, was one of total fear. Because if the Russians had a rocket strong enough to put a baseball in space, a little satellite in space, to get it up that far, they had a rocket that could hit any city in the United States.
Red Square invites the world to look in, for this is one of Moscow's banner attractions. New weapons are moved before the cameras, just enough of them to toy with the imagination.
In retrospect, in fact, we were well ahead in science and in the space race and in weaponry and in air power. But we have been in this competition with them, and here is this breakthrough, identifiable breakthrough, in the world of space, and they get there first.
Cape Canaveral, Florida. Scientists check out America's first test satellite, a 3-pound, 6.5-inch sphere equipped with a tiny radio transmitter and protruding antennae.
With the Soviets setting the pace, the U.S. rushed its first space probe to the launch pad in December of 1957. It
catapulted 300 miles into space. And towering 72 feet over the sands, the 11-ton rocket is ready for firing.
Kaputnik, the international press dubbed the failed Vanguard effort. The public disaster prompted Americans to wonder, where had they gone wrong?
That kind of put an end to the revelries of the 1950s, to the notion of self-fulfillment and enjoyment and rock and roll and sex and big birthday cakes. Suddenly, life had become very serious.
I've been waiting in school all day long, waiting on the bell to ring so I could go home. Throw my books on the table, pick up the telephone.
Critics said the American education system was at fault. Soviet children spent 33 more days a year in school than Americans, and more scientists per capita graduated from Soviet universities. Baby boomers suddenly found the Cold War reflected in their curriculum.
The best thing to happen to the American education system was that the Russians sent Sputnik up. We had to put money in the sciences. And so we started funding. We started opening the coffers and putting money into science and the academy, and that kind of spread out into the humanities and everywhere else. And suddenly new schools were being built everywhere, and more kids were coming into the schools. And if the Russians hadn't sent up Sputnik, who knew what would have happened?
While a generation of baby boomers were honing their skills in science and math, events 90 miles off America's coastline would put the nation's resolve to contain the Soviet Union to the test. In 1959, a young rebel leader named Fidel Castro overthrew Cuba's corrupt Batista regime.
Those of us who were in Havana at that time thought that Castro had to be better than Batista. We had no idea that Castro would turn out to be the kind of dictator that he did turn out to be.
Cuba's Fidel Castro arrives at New York's Idlewild Field, the first in a parade of heads of government that includes nearly every Iron Curtain nation and Russian ally.
Castro moved to nationalize American property in Cuba and turned to the Soviet Union for foreign aid and military support.
Unlike the three or four...
Seen through the harsh lens of Cold War politics, the charismatic Cuban became a made-for-TV villain.
Any good revolutionary has to be conscious of the media. Fidel Castro knew that early on, and he used us to great effect. Suddenly, in the fatigues and the beard and the cigars and the long speeches and the shaking of the head, he was a wonderfully theatrical figure. Agree or disagree, you had to pay attention.
Beyond Castro's image was the reality that Cuba was closely allied with a nuclear-armed superpower.
There is a limit to what the United States and self-respect can endure. That limit has now been reached.
Castro marks the second anniversary of his revolution with the biggest military parade ever staged in Cuba.
The country that had once been a convenient playground for American tourists now represented the front lines in the battle with communism, a specter that would haunt American diplomacy for years to come.
In his long campaign of provocation and harassment. Thank You, Ike Day is the theme for the thunderous welcome.
Dwight Eisenhower had been the perfect president for the 1950s.
Where Ike and Mamie hold center stage while convention business waits in the wings.
But now, his political party had a serious problem. The failure in Cuba and the setback in space were signs that new times required a new style of leadership.
To lead us to a fruitful America, to a peaceful world for mankind everywhere, is the great senator from the state of Massachusetts, John F. Kennedy.
I think there was a sense about John Kennedy of the newness, young family, and the sense that he was cool, rational, modern, contemporary, and that therefore the men around him were as well. There was a promise of not being too burdened by the past.
John F. Kennedy settles into office as the 35th President of the United States, the youngest man and the first Roman Catholic ever elected to the office. The first president born in the 20th century, he comes to office after one of the narrowest elections in American history.
Americans had chosen their leader as much for his glamour and energy as for the substance of his policies. They had chosen him in their own image, a young country on the move. The road ahead promised a new era of economic growth and social harmony.
Let the word go forth from this time and place to friend and foe alike that the torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans born in this century, tempered by war, disciplined by a hard and bitter peace, proud of our ancient heritage, and unwilling to witness or permit the slow undoing of those human rights to which this nation has always been committed.
After only 1,000 days of life on Kennedy's new frontier, Americans would long for what seemed to them simpler times, the 1950s.
My friend,
there's an old saying that the 4th of July is not now and never was what it used to be, and there's a tendency to romanticize the 50s and to forget the narrowness, the prejudice, but I think there's a generally far greater freedom and a sense of possibility, economic and other, today than in the past.
What's important about the 50s is that everybody opened their eyes up and learned to see pictures and take pictures seriously. It's the most visual decade in our history, and it made us who we are today.
We came to the conclusion that we were going to live for something or we were going to die for nothing.
The 50s, for me, were a time of tremendous change and promise, where it felt that just a few people maybe could sort of change the world.
In our love of everything new and modern, a lot of wonderful old things got torn down to make way for new parking lots, new shopping malls. And exciting as that might have been, I mean, a lot was lost as well.
The legacy was a legacy of hope and dreams. So those of my generation still carry those hopes and dreams. I'm not sure that our children care them nearly as enthusiastically as we did.
There'll never be another 50s. It is the most influential thing, and it wasn't by accident. The time was ready. We delivered the goods.